Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and it's Thursday, and that means open forum. And open forum means if you have something you would like to know about the Catholic Church, about the Catholic faith, Catholic traditions, Catholic people, this is the day for you, because we are open to any question having to do with the Catholic Church. 888-318-7884 is the number. If you're a Catholic and there's something that maybe you struggle to understand or that maybe you need to explain to somebody and you need some help explaining it, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. And if you're not a Catholic, I think we might even put you to the front of the line today. It just feels like not too many non-Catholics have called on open forum lately. So everybody's welcome. 888-318-7884. Our guest answering your questions this hour is Mark Brumley. Mark has a master's degree in theology from the University of Dallas, and he's a former staff apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of, wait for it, The Seven Deadly Sins of Apologetics. And now he's the president of Ignatius Press, one of the finest Catholic publishers anywhere at any time. Mark Brumley, thanks for being with us.
Great to be with you. You didn't say anywhere in the universe.
No, I got that. Actually, I have to say, I got the impression you were tired of me, that you had tired of my enthusiasm for the intergalactic import of. I thought maybe last time.
You never tire me.
Oh, okay. All right. So
When you said universe before, I think I was a little concerned that you were selling short the multiverse.
Yes. I remember we did argue about that. I hope it hasn't hurt our friendship. But
I don't think it has. But there are people in parallel universes that are a little concerned that you're not sensitive to their needs.
Can you read an Ignatius Press book in an alternate universe, or is it unreadable? Like, I don't know how that works. Like, you can read things from this universe and other universes?
Yeah, there actually are other universes where Ignatius Press books are very popular and people read them. Yeah,
I'm so amazing. Glad to hear it. What about like one I hope they can get in all of the universes? I don't know how many universes there are. Maybe just this one. We don't know, I guess. But the Ignatius of Loyola movie. That's you guys, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You guys, and is it called Ignatius of Loyola, or am I remembering that wrong?
Is what called Ignatius
the movie.
Of Loyola? The movie. Yes. I think it's Ignatius of Loyola. Yeah, that's a great movie.
Oh man, I just dumped that on. And you guys are also, in addition to being in the multiverse, you're also on Formed.
We are.
Yeah, you got a lot of,
and you are too. So we're like Formed cousins.
Right. And a gentleman was here today from the Augustine Institute. He was visiting us. And I just got to meet him. And you feel like they do such great work. And it's weird because there's no sense, I don't feel it anyways, of competition among these institutions. It feels like everybody's trying their very best to put the best Catholic material out there. And so we're all partners in Formed. .com.
Well, that's the idea. That's the idea behind Forum, to try to bring people together, as many together as possible. And you know, people are going to find, you know, that they like this group, this video product better than that, or this book or that. You know, that's all fine. That's the way the world works. And people have their different tastes. But the idea is to create a space, a digital platform space where we can bring people the best of video, audio, ebooks, and eventually, you know, whatever else emerges. If they have three-dimensional holographic projections,
that's common.
We hope to be able to provide that.
Yeah.
So that's the idea behind Formed and the Augustine Institute and Ignatius Press and now Catholic Answers and some various other groups are involved with Formed and putting our stuff out there. And I don't remember all the details on this, but I think they're like 600,000 plus registered users.
Wow. And parishes can
parishes, whole dioceses. I think there are something like 40 whole dioceses that are signed up, that kind of thing. So
We have a ton of people on the phone, but I have a privilege as the host. I get to ask the first question if I have a question.
Okay.
So may I ask you a first question?
That was your first question. The
no.
answer is yes.
Oh,
so now we can go
it.
To the
it was
the
a trick. All right, here's my question. Laurel, what did you hear? What did you hear?
Yes.
Wait, well, I'll say it again. I'll say it again.
This whole...
Ready? Yanny. Yes. Okay, what did you hear?
I heard Laurel.
You heard Laurel. All right. If you don't know what we are talking about,
there's a good chance many people don't.
You don't have internet access because it's like that dress a few years ago. Where is the dress gold or is the dress blue? And obviously it was gold. Everybody else was wrong. But now they have this thing where you listen to it and some people hear Laurel and some people hear Yanny, and it's wild. Show of hands in the booth. How many heard Laurel when you heard it? Just our video guy Brandon says he heard both because he's Mr.
Oh,
Fancy.
Interesting.
All right, I just
you know
wanted
what it
to
reminded
say,
me of
what
in the book of Acts when our Lord appears to Saint Paul. Saint Paul obviously communicates with the Lord, and elsewhere in Acts, you know, I think that's Acts 9 where that was that encounter. But elsewhere where it's where Paul narrates again what happened, you know, it's said that. That those who were with him didn't hear anything.
Yeah.
And yet in another place, it's heard, they hear a sound, but it's not clear what they hear. And so I kind of thought of this that came
Isn't
to mind,
funny?
You know,
yeah.
that it takes a certain perception to hear the voice of God, to hear the voice of Christ. Otherwise, it can just be noise.
That is such a good, what, look at that. You made very good use of that. But that's the truth, isn't it? That and then when you find, I think for most people, when they find Jesus, it's like, oh, it was there all the time. That voice was there
yeah.
all the time. And
yeah.
now I'm making it out. That's a nice.
I think that's true.
Yeah. Nicely done, Mark Brumley. We have Mike in Chicago on Facebook Live. He wants to ask you a question. Is that all right?
Sure.
All right, Mike in Chicago, you are on with Mark Brumley. Your question, please.
What does it mean to be a real Christian?
Well, it depends on what you mean by real Christian, but a Christian is someone who has a relationship with Christ. When you use the word real, I think you imply that there are some people who may seem like they're Christians, but they're not. Is that what's behind the question?
Yeah, like when you encounter a Christian, how do you know whether they are a real Christian or a phony Christian?
Ah, okay. So there's a lot we could say. In fact, we could take the whole show just talking about this question, because to be a Christian is to have a certain relationship with Christ, and that relationship is founded on God's grace. So God's grace is present within the soul or spirit of the person involved. And so the question is, you know, we can't peer into people's souls. So how do we know that that relationship exists? Well, there are all kinds of things that point to different aspects of that relationship. For one, we might say, is this person baptized? Baptism, validly administered, establishes a relationship between the person who's baptized and Christ. It's a relationship founded on God's grace and God's life. But, as we know, there are plenty of people who have been baptized who are not living up to that baptism. So that relationship, which has started in baptism, it can be a seed that's planted in baptism, hasn't come to fruition because that person is not living the life of faith, hope, and charity. So how would we detect whether someone is a, quotes, real Christian? By that I mean someone who's acting consistent with his relationship with Christ. We'd have to say, how is he living? Is he living a life of faith, of hope, and charity? Does he manifest the relationship with Christ that is interior by his external actions and by his attitudes expressed in his actions? So I think that's a question of how we know someone or how we can see that someone is a Christian. You know, Jesus put it more simply when he says you judge a tree by its fruits, and he talks about his disciples. We'll know his that we are his disciples by how we live, by our life of charity and our life of love. So I think these are all things that point to whether or not someone has this relationship founded on God's grace with Christ.
Mike, how does that strike you?
What kind of actions or fruits, as you said, like what concrete actions or fruits indicate a real Christian?
I would say, how does the person live his life? Does he live a life of faith? Does he live a life of charity and love of God and love of neighbor by what he's doing? You know, those are all things that point to the presence of God's life and grace in the person in question. So that's what I would say.
Okay, Mike.
I was looking for like concrete signs.
Well,
okay. Well, does the person pray? Does the person go to church? Does the person care for the poor? Does the person love his enemies? Those are all things that are indicative of someone who has a relationship with Christ founded on God's grace.
And we will have to leave it there. Mike, I hope that that was helpful to you, but we have to take a quick break. Mark Brumley is our guest. Open forum is our topic. That means whatever's on your mind about the Catholic Church, Catholic people, Catholic faith, Catholic history. We're here to take those calls. 888-318-7884 is the number. We'll be right back with more with Mark Brumley on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
This is Dale Alquist of the American Chesterton Society, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Can a moral relativist object to God's goodness based on the problem of evil? The answer is no, at least when it comes to moral evil, and here's the reason. You see, moral relativism states no moral truths exist independently of the individual. That's to say, what is right and wrong is relative to what the individual determines. Now, how can a relativist deviation from his own moral standard be considered morally evil when there's nothing to oblige him to follow his moral standard? The answer is, it can't. But if no moral evil can exist within the mental framework of moral relativism, well then obviously a relativist's complaint about the problem of moral evil is useless. So the relativist either has to give up the complaint about the problem of moral evil to keep relativism, or give up relativism to keep the complaint about the problem of moral evil. The relativist can't have both. I'm Carlo Broussard with the Ready Reason for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Tim Staples here. Since May is the month of Mary and Mother's Day, I'm offering a great opportunity for you to help yourself, your family, and your friends to get to know our Blessed Mother more deeply than ever before. And to help make that happen, we're offering my book, Behold Your Mother, a biblical and historical defense of the Marian doctrines for only $9.95. Folks, that's over 45% off the regular price. From her Immaculate Conception to the Annunciation, from her title as Mother of God to her perpetual virginity, from her assumption into heaven to her role as co-redemptrix, I'll give you all the facts and back them up with solid biblical evidence in a way that's easy to read, remember, and understand. Make this May the month you, your friends, and your family grow closer to the Mother of the Church, our Mother Mary. To get your copies of Behold Your Mother, call 1-888-291-8000 or log on to the shop at Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, open forum. Mark Brumley, our guest. Mark is the president of Ignatius Press, the nation's largest distributor, publisher of videos and music and books of a Catholic nature, and also well-known and well-respected all across the multiverse. We have on the line Cody in Tulsa, Oklahoma, watching on Facebook Live. Thanks, Cody, for watching on Facebook Live. Your question for Mark.
Thanks. So the gist of my question is, how do we put Lucifer in our perspective? There seems to be a dichotomy between Satan and God, but how are we supposed to look at Lucifer?
Not sure I understand the question. I mean, how are we to understand his existence, or how he interacts with us?
How he interacts with us, you know, is he big, small, compared to some of the archangels like Michael, and also if he's omnipresent too. Yeah.
So in our Christian understanding of things, we'd say that God is infinite, eternal, all-powerful, all-loving, and that's what full-blown, full-bodied existence is, to be God. Everything else is a creature, part of creation. So that means in some way it's finite, it's not eternal, it's caused, it's dependent, it's not all-powerful, it's not all-knowing, it's not omnipresent, okay? Now, within the order of creation, there are different levels of being, and the angels have a higher level of being from a certain perspective than human beings, and Satan, Lucifer, was once the greatest of the angelic beings. And because he rebelled against God, he fell. We talk about his falling into sin. He remains a very powerful spiritual being, but because he's not God, he's a created being, he is finite, he's limited, he's not all-knowing, he's not all-powerful, and he's not everywhere. Now, he has other angelic beings who are on his side in the struggle of good versus evil, and therefore they form a kind of anti-communion, if you will, of anti-saints, spiritual beings who are at odds with God and God's purposes. And so there are lots of them, and they can make it seem as if Satan and his diabolical forces are everywhere, but they're not. And it can make it seem as if they're all-powerful, but they're not. If they were, if God were not keeping them in check, and the good angels were not keeping them in check, our world would be in chaos. These beings would be distorting reality all the time and subjecting us to spiritual attack all the time. So they are not to be taken lightly. Satan is not to be taken lightly. But he shouldn't be regarded as all-powerful or everywhere and able to do anything. Does that help, Cody?
Absolutely. And you answered some of my sub-questions, too. So I appreciate that.
Mark will do that. That's why we have him on. He'll answer your questions and your sub-questions. Josh in Houston, Texas, listening to EWTN on Sirius XM Satellite Radio. You are on with Mark Brumley. Your question, please, Josh.
Hi, yes. If Jesus is fully man and fully God, when we worship Jesus, are we also worshiping in some sense humanity or elevating humanity, not just the divine part, but also his humanness?
Interesting question. I said earlier, with respect to one of the questions, we could devote the whole hour of the show to it, and this is one of those questions, too. A couple of points to bear in mind. When we talk about Jesus being true God and true man, we're speaking of a coming together, a union of two natures. Nature is that aspect of existence that we say popularly, there's more to it philosophically, popularly we say it responds to the question of what. And it determines the kind of activity, it's the principle of action of a being. So we say with respect to Jesus, he has a human nature and a divine nature. Human nature, and therefore he can act in a human way. He has the divine nature, and therefore he can act in a divine way. But when we talk about the one who possesses these natures, the one who is the source or cause of the action, whether it's dying on the cross, which is something that happens in Jesus's humanity, or his being involved with the creation of the world, which is something that's involved with his divinity, we have to say there's a person who is acting humanly or divinely. And the person who is acting, person here responds to the question, who, as nature responds to the question, what. Who is acting is the second person of the Trinity, the divine Son. So when we engage in an act of worship, we acknowledge and honor and revere Jesus. It is the second person of the Trinity, the divine Son, who is being worshiped and honored and revered. We're not worshiping and honoring created nature, although that created nature, that humanity, that human nature that Jesus possesses, is united in this second person. So it's not as if you could detach Jesus's humanity from his identity as the second person of the Trinity, but we can distinguish person and nature, and when we do that, make that distinction, we can understand that the person, the who, the one personal reality that we are worshiping when it comes to Jesus of Nazareth is God himself, the second person of the Trinity. So does that help clarify things a bit, Josh?
It does. You know, it seems that Christianity and Catholicism in particular, in its theology, it can be looked at in a deep way. It elevates humanity in a certain sense at the same time as clarifying God. So it's a complicated question. I think you made some good nuances there. Thanks.
Right, and you raised a good point. We want to add the complementary element that through the incarnation and the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, in the ascension of Jesus, humanity has been divinized. That is to say, it's come to share in the life of God. It's been elevated. Now, that doesn't mean that human nature as such, and every person who possesses human nature, is the uncreated, eternal, infinite, timeless, all-powerful, omnipresent God, but it does mean that by the incarnation, we can become God-like. We come to possess certain similarity to God, come to share in God's own life. So I sometimes try to sum up the principle of Christology, which is the theological study of Christ, by saying who and what the Son is as the second person of the Trinity, he becomes in space and time through the incarnation in human history, so that we, human beings, men, can, by union with him, become what he is insofar as it is possible for a finite being, such as we are, to share in that. So those are two complementary elements. We worship God and God alone in the sense of giving highest respect, honor, commitment, love, all of that. We worship God and God alone. Jesus is the second person of the Blessed Trinity, and therefore he is God and divine, and we worship him. By virtue of his incarnation, he has associated himself from all eternity, even though in space and time, the incarnation happened from our perspective at a particular point in time, from all eternity, since God is timeless, he's been united with the human nature. Because of that, human nature has been elevated and takes on certain divine characteristics. And we human beings, because of our communion with Christ, when we enter into communion with Christ, we begin.
Did we just lose Mark there? Oh, well, Josh, did you get what you wanted from Mark? Are you there with me, Josh?
Yeah, I thought it was I'm here. I thought it was a great answer, and yeah, I just kind of echoed the idea of how.
I'm sorry, Josh, we had a little technical trouble there. But you know what, it was I was really enjoying the conversation between the two of you, because I guess there's just very little that we can do in our life that is as edifying to appreciate who Christ is, because it does that reminds us who we are and what our value is. Mark, now I think Josh is gone now, and we've got you back, Mark.
Okay.
Are you here with us?
I am here.
So that whole process that you were describing is called theosis, right? That's the usual word for it, becoming like
theosis,
God.
Theosis, divinization, yes.
Or divinization, yep. Mark, thanks very much. Sorry we dropped you out there for a quick second. Josh, thank you for your patience.
You said so, you know?
Wait.
Didn't want to talk to you, she just said so.
We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live Open Forum with Mark Brumley right after this.
Most men will do almost anything to avoid deep theological discussions. Well, you don't need a doctorate in theology to listen to and enjoy the Catholic Cafe. Join me, Deacon Jeff Drzymski, along with my trusty sidekick, Tom Dorian, as we try and make manly sense out of living the Catholic faith.
The Catholic Cafe, Saturdays at 4 p.m. Eastern and Sundays at 5 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio. Live truth, live Catholic.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know that Catholic Answers Live is on TV? What began as a monthly series on EWTN in April of 2017 is now going to be coming to you on a weekly basis. You can catch Catholic Answers Live TV Saturdays at 5 p.m. Eastern Time on EWTN, with an encore at 2:30 a.m. on Sundays. We'll also be available soon on Apple TV, Roku, and the Augustine Institute's multimedia platform, Form. Make a point of making Catholic Answers Live TV part of your weekly viewing, and we'll see you on the airwaves. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, where we turn technical difficulties into a good thing. Well, that, I guess, no, we're not that good yet, but we're trying to have fun. Mark Brumley is our guest. We don't know what happened. We just lost him for a second there. Mark is the president of Ignatius Press. Our topic today is whatever's on your mind about the Catholic faith, about the Catholic Church, about Catholic people and what we do and what we believe. All that stuff is welcome because it's open forum. 888-318-7884 is the number. If you are not a Catholic and you have a question about us Catholics, something that you find challenging or difficult to grasp, or you just don't know what it is that we're saying when we say that, give us a call. 888-318-7884. If you're a Catholic who needs something kind of straightened out, we got lots of we have a lot of beliefs and practices. So there's probably an infinite number of questions that even a Catholic could ask about the Catholic faith.
There are. It sounds odd, but you can always ask another question.
Yeah, yeah. It's inexhaustible, which I guess that's a good thing. We wouldn't want to run out of stuff. Anne in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Listening on Ave Maria Radio, you are on with Mark Brumley. Ann, your question.
Hi, I was heading out to the garden to plant more vegetables, and I heard that you were taking questions, and I've always wondered, is there a saint that lived with a spouse who had antisocial personality disorder? I know they didn't call it that then, but what I mean is no empathy, doing cruel things, or really bad things and not feeling bad, etc. Did any saint live with that? Is there a book about it?
You know, off the top of my head, I can't think of a book. I can think of saints who lived with spouses who were kind of cruel, at least to some degree. But I can't specifically antisocial personality. I can't think of. I mean, I think Saint Augustine's mom, Saint Monica, her husband was, a bit of a pill frequently enough, and she really struggled with him later in life. I think he underwent a conversion, but I don't know that I would describe his personality as antisocial, at least not in the clinical sense of that term. So no, I can't, off the top of my head, no particular saint comes to mind, but I'm sure there have been saints who've had spouses who were, you know, very cruel and seriously had serious problems, let's say, relating to other people properly.
Doesn't Hosea have a wife that gives him some trouble in the Bible? Am I thinking of the wrong guy or
no? That is in the Old Testament. The question, yes. So the question is, Hosea's wife, was she a loose woman from the outset, or did God command Hosea to marry a woman who wound up being a loose woman? In either case, she's a loose woman.
Oh, so that's not quite the same. Any particular reason you ask? You have somebody that needs help in a situation like that, or some inspiration?
The life without separating, and can you do it in God's will, and can you do it to become holier?
Oh, you mean remaining with a difficult spouse?
A spouse who is antisocial, personality disorder. It's a mental health issue. It's not mental illness. Can a spouse stay and not leave and become holier dealing with it? As most people say, separation is in order.
Okay, fair enough.
You may a spouse do that? Is that a moral thing to do? And I think the answer is it can be. At the same time, people have to be careful. You know, they shouldn't remain in situations if they're physically threatened, or even not necessarily physically threatened, but deeply emotionally threatened. So I would hesitate to kind of give what some might regard as a glib answer and say, you know, it's just a matter of, yes, you just offer it up and put up with that, and you'll grow in holiness. But in fact, it is possible to do that, but you have to be very careful, and it would be something I think if one is aware of a spouse who engages in that kind of antisocial activity and has an antisocial personality, I think there should be some kind of counseling on the part of the spouse who isn't the antisocial spouse to make sure that there's no that the person isn't suffering unnecessarily. So I think we just have to be very careful. In the past, in societies where it was more difficult, especially for women, to separate from, I'll use a different term, an abusive spouse. And I know antisocial personality is the same as being an abusive person. But in the past, when that was the case, as I say, women often found it more difficult to separate for all kinds of reasons. We don't want people to feel like they need to put themselves at physical or serious emotional risk, in order to grow in holiness. I think that people need to have good spiritual guidance, good psychological guidance, good marital guidance in the process of discerning how to deal with those kinds of personalities.
And we will leave it there. And I hope that was helpful. I'm just having a little, I'm not certain of all of our connections today, so I'm going to keep moving. But Anne, for whoever that was asked for, on whoever's behalf that was asked for, we certainly would keep that person in our prayers. And we appreciate your call. Hope it was helpful, the answer. Let's go to Francisco in Birmingham, Alabama, listening on EWTN radio there. Francisco, your question for Mark Brumley.
Yes, it's a simple question. Is Judas in heaven or hell? The reason is, in order to fulfill the scripture, somebody's going to trade Jesus and he was the chosen. So I want to hear your opinion.
Well, I don't know the answer to the question for certain. There certainly is a lot of things in Scripture that would lead you to suppose that he is. But if I'm understanding the burden of your question, it seems to be how could Judas stand condemned for betraying Jesus if Judas's role as the betrayer was something that was prophesied and his actions were, in that sense, a fulfillment of Scripture? Is that the thrust of your question, Francisco?
Yes. Yes, yes.
Well, I'm going to take it the other way,
yes.
And I'm going to say that it would not have been prophesied that Judas was going to betray Jesus if Judas was not going to be one who would choose to betray Jesus. In other words, it's because of Judas's abuse of his freedom in betraying Jesus that prophets were able to prophesy that by gift of God, because God, outside of time, is able to see what Judas chooses when Judas chooses it, and therefore is able to anticipate from the perspective of human beings in time to give them an advanced knowledge of what's going to happen. But it's not as if there was a prophecy first that then had to be fulfilled and Judas was compelled to act in accord with the prophecy. Rather, God, who is the Lord of eternity and outside of time, is able to see what choice Judas makes and therefore is able to, without going into details, we don't, in the Old Testament, although Judas's betrayal is prophesied, it's not prophesied in a way that it's manifest who it is and when he's going to do it and how he's going to do it and all that. But God is able to communicate in advance of the choice from the point of view of the people in the Old Testament, in advance of Judas's choice, he's able to communicate that such a choice will be made by Judas, but it's Judas's abuse of freedom in betraying Jesus that is the cause of Judas's eternal destiny, not because of some event that was prophesied beforehand. Does that? I know it's very difficult. It's a difficult idea to talk about past, present, future in a way that respects human freedom, and then also to bring into the picture the complicating element of God being not unlimited by time and therefore able to know what we do when we do it, and also to be able to inspire someone in another point in history with some knowledge of something that we are going to do at a particular point in the future.
Francisco, we got to take a break, so we will leave it there. Thank you very much for that question. Mark Brumley is our guest this hour. It's open forum both hours today. Next hour, Jimmy Akin will be here. So do not despair if you feel like you're on the line or you've been thinking about calling and you haven't done so yet. You still have plenty of time to get your question in. Just get in the queue at 888-318-7884. We'll be right back with more. Mark Brumley on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
Catholic Answers. Our success depends on you.
This summer is the 50th anniversary of Pope Paul VI's landmark encyclical, Humanae Vitae. It dealt with contraception, and when the anniversary occurs, we can expect the media to go nuts. Volley after volley will be fired against the Church and its teaching. The attack will start all over again in October when Paul VI will be declared a saint. All of us can expect to get questions and challenges. We can foresee this attack. There's no doubt it's coming. That's why it's important that we prepare for it now. And that's why Catholic Answers is releasing the brand new book, Inseparable, Five Perspectives on Sex, Love, and Life in Defense of Humanae Vitae. It's written by five authors with a passion for defending the Church's teaching on human life and contraception. The book is so significant that Cardinal Raymond Burke has agreed to write a special foreword to help underscore its crucial message. Developing and distributing soul-saving resources like Inseparable is the kind of effort that your generosity makes possible. To make your donation and get a free copy of Inseparable, visit Catholic.com and click the Inseparable banner. or call us toll-free at 888-291-8000. That's the Inseparable Banner at Catholic.com, or call toll-free 888-291-8000.
Pope Francis said, "The key that opens the door to faith is prayer." Join St. Paul Street Evangelization by running a prayer station in the public square. You don't need to be a professional apologist or theologian. Just listen to the needs of the people you encounter. Offer encouragement, take prayer requests, and pray with people. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Open forum. Our guest, Mark Brumley, is, in fact, the president of Ignatius Press. And on Facebook, John on Facebook is taking advantage of the fact that you are the president of Ignatius Press to ask, are there any more Michael O'Brien books in the works?
Well, there's a Michael O'Brien biography that's coming out next year. There's a Michael O'Brien book on Michael O'Brien's art, which is a very beautiful book. I mean, we're in the process of publishing it, so we've seen the art that's going to be included. It's outstanding. I encourage people to get it when it comes out. And then you never know when Michael O'Brien might pen another novel and send it our way. So we'll have to see if there's another work of fiction coming out. We're going to come out with a updated edition of Father Elijah. Nothing significant has changed, yeah. But I think that's not what the person on Facebook is looking for. He's looking for a new novel.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Father Elijah freaked me out. I was looking for the Antichrist for about a year after reading that book.
That freaked you out, huh?
Is that him? Is that him over there? Who is
it? Did you get Elijah in Jerusalem?
I read was that one of the subsequent ones?
Yeah, that you should get that. That is that's what happens to Father Elijah after Father Elijah.
Oh, really?
After the end of the book, Elijah in Jerusalem. And I have to say,
it's good.
First of all, I thought Father Elijah was spiritually insightful, but
yes,
you know, it's in many ways it's a page turner kind of spiritual thriller.
You say that like it's a bad thing, like a page turner. You say page turner, you kind of a little negative.
Yeah, what I mean by that, I was going to finish the idea, the thought there. There are spiritual insights in Father Elijah. I would encourage people to read it.
Yeah.
But you know, it's more of a kind of fast-paced kind of exciting novel, which is great. People love that sort of thing. I like that sort of thing too. But a lot of other of Michael O'Brien's other novels have, they're great characters and great stories, but they have a kind of spiritual insight. It's almost like you're not just reading a novel, but you're reading a book of meditation or something of that sort. And I was going to say that Elijah in Jerusalem, it's a much shorter book, certainly has exciting plot, interesting characters. But I found reading it that it was just very, very spiritually insightful.
Oh, so, all right. I will.
Not that Father Elijah is not spiritually insightful, but in a just a very different way.
I can't go back to Father Elijah. I was looking over my shoulder for a whole year. We're looking for the Antichrist.
Well, you should again, get Elijah in Jerusalem.
All right. I will. Elijah in Jerusalem. All right. I wish I knew the publisher. I could maybe mooch a copy off of. But that's all right. Well, that's for another time. We'll... Bill in Levittown, Pennsylvania, listening on Fulton J. Sheen Radio. Oh, that reminds me of my friend Terry Barber. Full Sheen ahead. Bill, your question for Mark Brumley.
My question is, what is the difference between a general confession and an ordinary confession that somebody does on a Saturday afternoon?
Yeah. A general confession, I mean, first of all, when you go to confession, you are required to confess all mortal sins that you've committed since your last confession, assuming you can remember them, obviously, but you have to make a good confession. You have to make a serious effort to remember all mortal sins that you have committed since your last confession. And but you don't have to go to confession. You have to have sins to confess, as what we call matter for the sacrament, but they don't necessarily have to be mortal, and they don't necessarily have to be things that you haven't confessed before. You can revisit something you've done before. You have to avoid being scrupulous, but you can bring up something that you've, a sin that you've committed before, that you want to express sorrow for having done in the past. And a general confession is where you reflect on the course of your life and things that you're sorry for, even things that you've already confessed before in the sacrament, and you express sorrow and repentance for having done those things again. And so it's general in the sense that it's looking over the course of one's life and reflecting on the ways in which one judges oneself to have fallen short and sinned against God, and to offer that in spirit of repentance to God in confession, and to seek the spiritual consolation that comes from having confessed that and having repented of it. I've made general confessions before in my life. Usually they take a while, and you should, you know, kind of warn the priest what's coming so he doesn't, you know, think this is one of those quickie perfunctory confessions. But that's what a general confession is. Does that help, Bill?
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Have a blessed day. I've been following you guys for years, and you two have done a wonderful job.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Bill, for saying that. This will probably lower your opinion on me, but when I saw the question, what is a general confession, I was going to say it's a colonel confession that got a promotion. So that's probably best that I didn't. But Bill, thanks for the call. Bill's like, oh, man, I said something nice, and that guy is goofy. John in Laramie, Wyoming, listening to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio Channel 130. You are on with Mark Brumley. Your question, John. John? Nope. All right. We'll come back, John. It didn't sound like he was there, though. Shane in Ohio, also listening to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. Shane, your question for Mark Brumley.
Yes. I heard on the radio today, well, first, I'm not a Catholic, so I'm evangelical. But I heard about canonizing a saint, and so I wanted to understand better what that meant. And if that means that his writings are on par with what we would consider the scripture alone.
Very good. Shane, thanks for that call. I've been looking for the non-Catholic caller, and there he is. Thank you very much.
There you go. Shane. You got what you were looking for, man.
I appreciate it. So what does that mean for a saint to be canonized, and then does that mean the writings of that saint are elevated up to the level of scripture?
No, it doesn't mean that the writings of the saint are elevated to the level of scripture. I had this description of canonization from the catechism, the little glossary in the back of the Catechism of the Catholic Church, which I'd like to read. It says, canonization, the solemn declaration by the Pope that a deceased member of the faithful may be proposed as a model and intercessor to the Christian faithful and venerated as a saint on the basis of the fact that the person lived a life of heroic virtue or remained faithful to God through martyrdom. So that's a nice little summary there. Canonization, we say, typically we talk about canonization making someone a saint. Well, that's not accurate. Someone is a saint if someone is in heaven. And we talk about beatification as saying this person is beatified as in heaven. Canonization takes things a step further, and it says that this person is a model, can be a model for the faithful at large, and can be an intercessor. That is to say, someone who prays for us and to whom we can go, and someone who should be venerated and honored as someone who's been faithful to God in a life of heroic virtue, or who remained faithful as a martyr. Those are all examples of how someone can come to be canonized. So first someone is beatified, this is to say, declared to be with God, and then canonized, set up as a model for the whole church to emulate and to act as an intercessor, someone who can pray to the Father through the Son and the Holy Spirit for us, just as on earth we pray for one another. So this person who's in heaven in the very presence of God can pray for us.
What do you make of all that, Shane?
It helps explain. And I guess my second question was some resources to understand better how the difference between the Protestant and the Catholic as far as in faith alone in Scripture, so that sola scriptura. I can better understand the Catholic perspective of that.
Okay, Shane.
I suspect that Catholic Answers has some resources to help in that.
As a matter of fact, I was just thinking, I haven't given away any free books at all today. And Shane, I'm thinking Jimmy Akin's book, The Drama of Salvation. Jimmy grew up Protestant, became a Catholic, and is very conversant in all the different ways Catholics and Protestants talk about salvation and the Bible alone and faith alone theology. So if you don't mind giving us your address, I'll send you The Drama of Salvation. Oh, you know what? Let's also send you Trent Horn's book, Why We're Catholic, because that gets into some of that a little bit as well. Okay if we send you those books, Shane?
Yeah, that'd be great.
That's good. I love to send out free books because then those guys don't get a royalty on them. So, Shane, hang on. Aline is going to take your address, and then we'll send those books to you. And thanks so much for the call. Call anytime, okay, Shane?
Well, thank you.
All right. Thank you. Let's go now to Angel in Anaheim, California, watching on Facebook Live. Angel, thanks for watching on Facebook. Your question for Mark Brumley, and you're going to have to make it a little bit quick because we're heading towards the top of the hour.
Well, the question that I have is in Galatians 4:4, it says, God sent Jesus in the fullness of time. What does that mean? Why did God send him when he did? Why not earlier? Why not later?
God sent Jesus when he did because God is wise and loving. And God's wisdom said this is the best time to send Jesus for the purpose that the Father had in bringing humanity into right relationship with him and to bring about the salvation of the world. It's hard to go beyond that. We don't, you know, we can't know the mind of God, and we certainly could speculate on lots of things about why that particular time, that particular place, as opposed to today or some other time or place. But we have to ultimately leave the matter with the wisdom of God and God, and the fact that God sent his Son out of love. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, have everlasting life, John 3:16. Points to the motive of God in sending the Son, and then the divine wisdom, the fullness of time, which is another way of saying at the appropriate time, divine wisdom sent the Son when it was the wise thing to do. That's all we can say. It's a mystery beyond that.
Does that help you, Angel?
I mean, we can talk about, you know, the history of Israel leading up to that particular point and Israel's status in the world and the fact that the Roman world afforded an opportunity for mass communication, spreading the gospel, all that. But that's speculation. And we just have to leave the matter to God's wisdom.
Also heard about prophecies in the Old Testament, like in Daniel, of certain time that needed to happen, but I kind of remember hearing something about it, but I was just interested if there was a reason why it was
right
that time.
Well, and again, to go back to the question, earlier question about Judas, we have to, you know, it's not like God chose to give these prophecies and then he was forced, because he'd given these prophecies at an earlier time, to pull off certain things later on to make the prophecies true. He can plan things better than any human being can plan. So he chose when and where he was going to send the Son and prophesied in order to alert people that was going to happen.
Angel, thanks for that question. You can hear the music. That means we got to go. Mark Brumley from Ignatius Press, thanks so much.
Thank you. Good being with you.
Thanks for joining us in this universe of all the multiple universes you could have joined us in. Next up, Jimmy Akin will be here. If you're on the line, stay on the line. If you haven't dialed, 888-31-TRUTH is the number. Right back after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Bishop James Conley of the Diocese of Lincoln. Keep it right here on Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and you've probably heard me explain Catholicism to non-Catholic callers on the radio or engage opponents in formal public debates. I've always hoped these interactions would show people how to graciously defend and share our faith. But they're not enough. That's why I've created a weekly podcast that will help Catholics answer the toughest objections against our faith. Every episode of the Council of Trent will provide listeners with a conversation roadmap that will help them share their faith with anyone. Keep in mind that I hate boring lectures. These podcasts will contain entertaining, informative, and practical explanations of the faith, as well as interviews with the best Catholic writers and speakers in the world today. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com today to find out how you can subscribe to my new podcast. That's TrentHornPodcast.com.
Tim Staples here. Since May is the month of Mary and Mother's Day, I'm offering a great opportunity for you to help yourself, your family, and your friends to get to know our Blessed Mother more deeply than ever before. And to help make that happen, we're offering my book, Behold Your Mother, a biblical and historical defense of the Marian doctrines for only $9.95. Folks, that's over 45% off the regular price. From her Immaculate Conception to the Annunciation, from her title as Mother of God to her perpetual virginity, from her assumption into heaven to her role as co-redemptrix. I'll give you all the facts and back them up with solid biblical evidence in a way that's easy to read, remember, and understand. Make this May the month you, your friends, and your family grow closer to the Mother of the Church, our Mother Mary. To get your copies of Behold Your Mother, call 1-888-291-8000 or log on to the shop at catholic.com.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Got a question? Bring it on. Catholic Answers Live.
Did you know that Catholic Answers Live is on TV? What began as a monthly series on EWTN in April of 2017 is now going to be coming to you on a weekly basis. You can catch Catholic Answers Live TV Saturdays at 5 p.m. Eastern Time on EWTN, with an encore at 2:30 a.m. on Sundays. We'll also be available soon on Apple TV, Roku, and the Augustine Institute's multimedia platform, Form. Make a point of making Catholic Answers Live TV part of your weekly viewing, and we'll see you on the airwaves.
Tim Staples, Trent Horn, Cy Kellett, Chris Check, Carlo Broussard. Our on-fire lineup of speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker for your event, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Hello, my friends. This is Christopher Check, president of Catholic Answers. I'm sure you have heard that it's still okay these days to hold to the quaint superstitions of Catholicism as long as you leave them in church. Because when it comes to reality, religion is just foolishness that withers in the fierce light of science. Problem is, this narrative is false. It is in the Christian West that scientific discovery has most flourished. Still, too many of us find ourselves flat-footed when confronted with bugbears like Adam and Eve versus evolution, creation versus Big Bang, and Galileo versus the Inquisition. What can you do? Come to Catholic Answers' 5th National Conference, Faith and Science. Guest speakers Father Terry Ehrman and Dr. Stacy Trasankos will join the whole Catholic Answers team to explain how faith and science are actually in harmony. September 27 to 30, right here in San Diego. And we are thrilled to announce a special keynote address by Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke honoring the 50th anniversary of Humanae Vitae. For all the details, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll-free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's Thursday. It's open forum. And that means if you've got a question about the life, the faith, the history of the Catholic Church, all those questions are welcome. 888-318-7884, the number. And when we have Jimmy in here, Jimmy Akin is our guest this hour. He's senior apologist at Catholic Answers and the author of A Daily Defense, 365 Days Plus One to Becoming a Better Apologist. And when we have Jimmy, we broaden the net a bit. If you have a philosophical question, a question about world religions or religion in general, all of those are welcome as well. And I will try to repeat this as much as I remember. You don't have to be Catholic to call. Anybody can call.
Yeah.
888-318-7884. Hello, Jimmy. Welcome back.
Howdy, Si. How are you doing?
I'm very, very well. Nice to see you.
Likewise.
It used to be, I think our country has become very divided, Republicans and Democrats and liberals and conservatives. Yeah, I think it has happened.
No.
But I think there's a new division.
Okay.
And it's between the Laurels and the Yannies.
Oh, yeah. How about that?
Yeah. And obviously, we need to somehow get the Yannies out of the country. The Laurels are clearly... Did you listen to that thing? I asked Brumley about it.
I did.
And what did you hear?
I heard Yanny.
Oh, no.
Which means...
I'm so sorry, Jimmy. Some of my best friends are Yannies.
Yeah, well, apparently, one of the things that means is my ears are younger. So that was heartening to hear because it means I'm not suffering from at least frequency-related hearing loss because people who hear Laurel aren't picking up on some of the higher frequencies that are in the recording.
Right, and Darren couldn't hear Laurel at all. All he heard was Yanny, and he was all puffed up when he found out that meant he was hearing higher frequencies than us. But you know what? Who else hears the higher frequencies? Dogs
and teenagers.
That's right.
You know, there's even a device called the mosquito that is used in some places in front of stores to keep young people from loitering. And the way it works is it blasts out very high frequency noises that teenagers can hear, but that older people can't. And so it discourages the young people from hanging around.
Oh, that's just mean.
Also discovered a strategy that some places use to prevent loitering. Recently was May Day.
Yeah.
And on May 1st, I get together with a bunch of friends, and among other things, we go out to a coffee shop for breakfast. And and as I approached the coffee shop this year, I noticed they were playing classical music loudly out in front of it, you know, where they have like tables and chairs on the sidewalk.
Yeah.
And then when I went home just that day in my newsfeed, it popped up that some restaurants are playing loud classical music to discourage young people from loitering in front.
Because they don't like the classical music?
Apparently so. I've always, when I was in my teenage years, I loved the Brandenburg Concertos.
I had them
played on synthesizer. It was really cool.
You had a recording of them played on synthesizer?
Yeah.
Especially
Brandenburg Concerto number 3.
Go ahead, hum it. I really truly do not know what
it's too complex for me to hum on.
I thought you were going to say it's too complex for me to handle.
No.
But, okay.
That would be Brandenburg Concerto number 2, maybe. I don't know.
I just feel good that we can have this conversation and a Laurel and a Yanny can come together. treat one another with dignity.
You can hear it both. It's like the star-belly sneeches. I mean, you can hear it both ways. So whether you have a star upon yours or not, you can get it modified because they have devices. All you have to do is change the frequency, and you'll hear the other one. And in fact, there are websites and videos where they'll play it. If you play it with a 30% higher pitch, you'll hear Yanni, 30% lower pitch. Almost everybody hears Laurel. And so technology can bring us all together.
I am ashamed of this because I have lived much of my life in San Diego. And, you know, La Jolla is where Dr. Seuss is not from, mm-hmm. but where I don't get the Star-Belly Sneetches reference. What is that?
Really? Okay, so there's a Dr. Seuss book called The Sneetches, and it's about these whimsical creatures that many of them have plain bellies, but some have stars on their bellies.
Oh, yeah.
And they divide up tribalistically and get into competition, and then someone invents a starring machine that can put on or take off stars, and it's about the folly of human tribalism.
Oh, okay. I got you. So isn't that ridiculous? I totally missed the. Mm-hmm. It went right over my head. Dr. Seuss goes over my head.
Just remember, a person's a person, no matter how small.
That really should be the theme, or what do you call it? Like the tagline of the whole entire pro-life movement.
Mm-hmm.
Person's a person, no matter how small. And it took me years to figure out that the reason that Horton could hear them was because he's an elephant and he has big giant ears.
Yeah.
Come on, Cyril. Dr. Seuss is too advanced for me. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. It is open forum. Jimmy Akin is our guest. And our first call goes to Joseph in Dallas, Texas, listening on 9:10 a.m. Joseph, your question for Jimmy.
Hi, I'm recently converted to Orthodox Christianity,
mm-hmm.
and we were learning about, you know, Catholicism differences between us and y'all.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering why y'all say the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. We learned that was included in some translation. We say the Holy Spirit proceeds from just the Father in the Nicene Creed.
Well, so the Nicene Creed, as used in Orthodox churches, it doesn't say just the Father, it's that it only mentions the Father. And so actually there are a lot of Orthodox who don't have a problem with the formula from the Father and the Son, or an equivalent formula that means almost the same thing, from the Father through the Son. The Catholic Church doesn't have a problem with either of the formulations, and the reason that the theological tradition in the West has received this understanding is based on different factors. One of them is the way the persons of the Trinity are described in Scripture. So the Holy Spirit is not just described as the Spirit of God or the Spirit of the Father. It's also, the Holy Spirit is also described as the Spirit of the Son. And so that suggests that the Holy Spirit proceeds not only from the Father, but also from the Son. Now, because everything the Son has comes from the Father, the Father is the arche, or source, or principle of all of the persons of the Trinity, everything the Son has is from the Father. And so if the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Son, that only happens because that was part of the Father's self-giving to the Son. And so ultimately the Holy Spirit would come from the Father, but it would be by way of the Son. And so hence the formulation from the Father through the Son, because the Son has nothing independent of his own that wasn't given to him by the Father. So it's rooted in Scripture. One of the points, as I mentioned, is that the Holy Spirit is described as the Spirit of the Son. Also, the Holy Spirit is depicted as being sent into the world by the Son. Jesus talks about how he'll send the Holy Spirit after he ascends into heaven. And it's understood that the outward manifestations of the Trinity, like the sending of the Holy Spirit, reflect the inward relations of the persons in various ways. And also there's a theological argument, in addition to the biblical arguments that have been used to support this. There's also a theological one, which is since both the Son and the Holy Spirit proceed from the Father, there needs to be some difference in the relation in the relations involved, because otherwise the Holy Spirit would simply be a second Son. And Revelation does not depict the Holy Spirit as a second Son, but as the Spirit. And so there needs to be some kind of difference in the relations, and the fact that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father through the Son accounts for why the Holy Spirit is not simply a second Son. Also, it's understood in the West that the Holy Spirit as a person embodies the love between the Father and the Son, and love is a mutual thing that exists between two people, and so that also points in the direction of the Holy Spirit having a common, as the love between the Father and the Son, having a common origin in the two persons.
Okay, thank you so much.
No problem.
All right, thank you very, very much. We got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
Catholic Answers Live with Jimmy Akin is coming right back.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Tim Staples here. Since May is the month of Mary and Mother's Day, I'm offering a great opportunity for you to help yourself, your family, and your friends to get to know our Blessed Mother more deeply than ever before. And to help make that happen, we're offering my book, Behold Your Mother, a biblical and historical defense of the Marian doctrines, for only $9.95. Folks, that's over 45% off the regular price. From her Immaculate Conception to the Annunciation, from her title as Mother of God to her perpetual virginity, from her assumption into heaven to her role as co-redemptrix, I'll give you all the facts and back them up with solid biblical evidence in a way that's easy to read, remember, and understand. Make this May the month you, your friends, and your family grow closer to the Mother of the Church, our Mother Mary. To get your copies of Behold Your Mother, call 1-888-291-8000 or log on to the shop at Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. It is Open Forum today, and Jimmy Akin is our guest. Don't hold it against him, but he is a Yanni, not a Laurel. I said don't hold it against him, so does that show my open-mindedness and tolerance?
This whole Yanni Laurel thing is so 5 minutes ago.
It's already over. That's the way everything on the internet is. By the time I know about it, it's already over. Doggone it. All right, well, let's go to John. John in Laramie, Wyoming, listening to EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. You are on with Jimmy Akin. John, your question.
Yeah, hey, Jimmy. This is an honor to talk with you. Hey, I got a question. And 1 John chapter 5, 16.
Yeah.
At the end of 16, it says, there are such things as deadly sins, about which I do not say that you should pray. Mm-hmm. I'm confused on what it's asking us not to pray for, if I'm understanding that correctly.
So there are different ways of looking at this verse. and in order to understand it, we should back up a little bit and read it in context. Starting at the beginning of verse 16, John writes, if anyone sees his brother committing what is not a mortal sin, he will ask, and God will give him life for those whose sin is not mortal. There is sin which is mortal. I do not say that one is to pray for that. Now, the term, I'm quoting here from the Revised Standard Version Catholic Edition, and it translates the relevant Greek phrase as mortal sin. It sounds like the version that you're quoting from translates it deadly sin, which is another possible translation. Literally, what it says in Greek is sin unto death. And there's a judgment that has to be made about what that means. What does it mean to sin unto death? Some people, many people, take the death involved as spiritual death, in which case a sin unto death would be a sin that produces spiritual death, or what we would call a deadly sin or a mortal sin. And if that's how you take it, then it would seem that the way to understand the verse would be like this. If anyone sees his brother committing what is not a mortal sin, he will ask, and God will give him life, presumably spiritual life, if we've just been talking about spiritual death, for those whose sin is not mortal. So the idea would be that if someone has committed venial sin, then you could pray and God would continue to give that person his blessings in the form of spiritual life because their sin didn't result in spiritual death. But he then says that there is sin which is mortal, so it would lead to spiritual death. And he says, I don't say that one is to pray for that. And he could mean a couple of things at that juncture. He could simply mean, I'm not taking a position on whether one should pray for someone in that state, that he's just not addressing the question one way or another, because perhaps in his mind, it's an open question at this point about what value does prayer for those in mortal sin have. It could also mean, I'm not suggesting that you pray for those people to receive a direct infusion of spiritual life because they're in a state of mortal sin. They need to repent first. And then after they repent, you could pray and God will give them a new infusion of spiritual life. But until they repent, there's no point in praying that they be given spiritual life because they've closed themselves off from God, and that's the thing that needs to be addressed. Now, perhaps you could then, and today we would say you should, pray that someone repents, but that's not what John would be talking about on this interpretation of the verse. He would instead be talking about asking that God give someone spiritual life or additional spiritual life if they're in mortal sin. Having said all that, there are other ways of taking this verse. The phrase sin unto death doesn't necessarily mean spiritual death. It could mean physical death. And if it means physical death, then it could be taken, again, in two ways. It could mean, in the first place, a sin that brings about physical death. And in that case, John would be saying, as long as someone has sinned, but it hasn't produced physical death, then you can pray and God will continue to give them physical life in that case. But if they're already dead, it's a little harder to see the point of why you would pray that they be given physical life if they've physically died. And so it would make sense in that case for John to say, I'm not saying you should pray in that case because they're already dead. So there's not a point in asking God to give them physical life. On the other hand, the phrase sin unto death could be taken as a reference to sin continued unto the point of death. And that opens up a new possibility. If you've sinned but have not yet died, then you could pray for someone, even if they're in a state of what we would call mortal sin, and ask God to give them new spiritual life, to bring them to repentance and give them new spiritual life. But if they've died in mortal sin, then there's no point in praying for them because their fate is sealed. So there are a number of possibilities about how this verse could be taken, and it depends really on the key of the interpretation of the key phrase, sin unto death. Does it mean spiritual death? Does it mean a sin that produces physical death, or sin continued unto the point of physical death? Depending on how you take those and how you take the life, whether it's physical or spiritual life that you're asking God to give them, a number of different options exist for how to understand this verse.
John, I hope that was helpful. It was a lot, and so I will let you know, just in case you don't know, that after these shows are over, they're available to you on YouTube or Facebook, and Nick always posts the audio within about 24 hours of the show being over. So if you want to go back over it, you can get it there.
Or you can go immediately to YouTube or Facebook and watch it there just minutes after the show, because that posts automatically.
Or you could do that if you want to do it the easy way, John. What, you're probably a Yanni. Yanni? You know, I don't know.
5 minutes ago, dude.
Oh, man. Bianca in El Paso, Texas, you are on with Jimmy Akin. Your question, please.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
Well, I open the Bible and I read it, mm-hmm. and I feel very moved and close to God.
Awesome.
And I have a question mm-hmm. that I have not been able to find.
Okay.
Is it a sin to be cremated?
So during the break, this Cy was reading your question that you'd given the call screener, and he said, well, it is if you're not yet dead. I said, I know, right? In actuality, though, if you are dead, it is not a sin to be cremated. Our bodies naturally disintegrate anyway. That's right there at the beginning of the Bible. It's something we've known all the way through history. So God tells Adam, dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. So he acknowledges Adam's body is going to disintegrate. And cremation is simply is an acceleration of a process that's going to occur anyway. And so it's natural for our bodies to disintegrate and become little bitty particles. Anyway, cremation just does that more quickly. In some cases, when it can even be important if you have, like, say, in the wake of a natural disaster, you know, you have lots of people who've died for health reasons. You may need to cremate the bodies to prevent the spread of disease. So it's not an intrinsic problem. Now, there have been some people, apparently, in church history, who have wanted to be cremated as a kind of defiance of the Catholic faith, by say, for example, perhaps by saying things like, well, I don't believe in the resurrection of the dead, so I'm going to be cremated so God can't resurrect me. Well, okay, the thing is, God's omnipotent. He'll resurrect you anyway. So you're not
going to... Or maybe not.
You're not going to... No, he will. You're not going to stop God from resurrecting you. But if a person is wanting to be cremated as a sign of defiance against some aspect of the Catholic faith or the Christian faith more broadly, then it would be a sin to be cremated. But the sin is not in the act of cremation. The sin is in the act of defiance. So as long as you're not trying to be cremated as a sign of defiance, it's not a sin to be cremated.
Oh, thank you so very much. No, it's important to me, my love for my Heavenly Father, mm-hmm. and I appreciate the answer because I've been searching for an answer for a long time, and it worried me because I read in the scriptures about the lake of fire and all that, and mm-hmm. and I don't claim, I have a hard time understanding the Bible, and I read it all the time, and I'm starting to get a lot of answers, and I appreciate that, and I thank you so much.
Awesome. No problem. Keep listening. And by the way, the lake of fire is an image that the book of Revelation uses to communicate to us the suffering and frustration that people experience when they definitively cut themselves off from God. But it doesn't have anything to do with the earthly practice of cremation.
Bianca, thanks very, very much. And I'm having trouble. I don't know why, Bianca, just completing a sentence
you
today.
Use your words. But
I know. When you're on the radio, you should use words. That's one mm-hmm. of the things you should do. Yeah, Catholic.com, I was going to say, is a place where you can go. When you have a question like that, you can type in your question. And from the vast kind of library of answers that we've generated over the decades, you may find something that's helpful to you, and you're always welcome to call back here. Again, the number 888-318-7884. It is open forum today. Jimmy Akin is our guest. And Ray in Waukegan, Illinois, I'm going to have to ask you to give Jimmy your question. I can't guarantee that the answer will be finished by the time we have to go to a break. Ray, your question for Jimmy?
Hi, Jimmy. This is Ray. I asked you a couple of weeks ago the urgent question about my Catholic and Protestant friends getting married.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually have two questions. The second one is a lot quicker, but...
What is it?
The second one is, if my friend does not seek a reconciliation, would the marriage be valid?
Your friend's current situation?
My Catholic friend... I'm sorry. My friend's current situation is he is Catholic, mm-hmm. and was baptized in, quote unquote, rebaptized in a non-denominational church.
Okay.
And he.
Okay. So let me answer that because we're going to go to the break. The answer is that the way canon law is currently written, joining another church, even by, quote unquote, being rebaptized, which is not a valid baptism, but even if it, regardless of that, joining another church, even by a formal act like baptism, does not dispense you from the obligation to observe the Catholic form of marriage. And consequently, if he gets married in a Protestant church without permission from his bishop, then the marriage will be invalid.
Ray, hang on. We'll come back. We'll get to your other question right after this. It is open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin is our guest. 888-31-TRUTH is the number. We'll be right back with more of that after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Tim Staples here. Since May is the month of Mary and Mother's Day, I'm offering a great opportunity for you to help yourself, your family, and your friends to get to know our Blessed Mother more deeply than ever before. And to help make that happen, we're offering my book, Behold Your Mother, a biblical and historical defense of the Marian doctrines for only $9.95. Folks, that's over 45% off the regular price. From her Immaculate Conception to the Annunciation, from her title as Mother of God to her perpetual virginity, from her assumption into heaven to her role as co-redemptrix, I'll give you all the facts and back them up with solid biblical evidence in a way that's easy to read, remember, and understand. Make this May the month you, your friends, and your family grow closer to the Mother of the Church, our Mother Mary. To get your copies of Behold Your Mother, call 1-888-291-8000 or log on to the shop at Catholic.com.
What's stopping you from becoming a Catholic?
Why can't women become priests?
I don't understand why I have to earn salvation.
How is it possible that God created everything?
Why do I need to confess my sins to a priest?
Why is the Catholic Church so unwilling to
The Catholic Church is too rich.
Catholics worship Mary and are
committed. As far as I'm concerned, all religions are equal.
You are called to communion with Dr. David Anders. Tonight, 11 p.m. Eastern, on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
Yeah, that groovy music. Thanks, Nick. thought I waited to talk because I wasn't sure if it was going to loop, but no, there's that groovy music I wait for every week. I love that music. It's starting to become almost a habit, I think, that you're here with us when that music plays, Jimmy.
Spooky, isn't it?
It is spooky. I like it. I like sharing the groovy music with you. Appreciate that. When we left, we were talking with Ray in mm-hmm. Waukegan, Illinois. Ray, you had a second question that you wanted to ask to Jimmy Akin.
Yes. The two questions are, if my Catholic friend does not get baptized but seeks permission, or I'm sorry, my Catholic friend does not go to confession for being quote-unquote rebaptized, mm-hmm. is the marriage valid if he still gets permission and a dispensation? And my second question was, my pastor or a local priest actually told me that since my friend was publicly, he made a public declaration or a renouncement of his Catholic faith by being baptized in the non-denominational church, then by doing so, he no longer was bound by canon law and Catholic practice.
Your priest was probably educated a few years ago, and he's expressing a view that reflects the way canon law was written and interpreted after the release of the 1983 Code of Canon Law. The 1983 Code of Canon Law contained a provision that said those who formally defect from the church are not bound by the obligation of observing the Catholic form of marriage. And for a long time, the idea of joining another church by a formal act like being rebaptized would have been sufficient to count as defecting from the church by a formal act. However, there was debate about that, of exactly what counted as a formal act. And early in his reign, Pope Benedict XVI approved an authentic interpretation of that law, which spelled out the conditions on which a formal act would be committed, and they went beyond what we would ordinarily consider a formal act, like just joining another church. You had to do things like contact your bishop and tell him and have it registered in Catholic documents that you had left the church and so forth. Simply going and joining another church wasn't enough. So that tightened it up to where merely being rebaptized in another church wouldn't be enough. And then in 2009, Pope Benedict issued a motu proprio in which he altered the text of the relevant canon in the Code of Canon Law so that it no longer contained the formal defection exception. So the way the law is written now, which is how I began my answer, the way it's written now, your friend is not dispensed or excused from the obligation to observe the Catholic form of marriage, and so he would need to if he's marrying a non-Catholic, a Protestant Christian, he would need permission for that, and he would need a dispensation from observing the Catholic form of marriage in order to be validly married in a Protestant church. How likely he wouldn't technically need to go to confession for that. That going to confession is an independent process. He would need to go to confession, but for spiritual reasons rather than for legal reasons. I don't know how likely he is if he's joined another church to be inclined to pursue getting permission or a dispensation from his bishop, but that's what he would need to do the way the law is written now for his marriage to be valid.
Ray, I'm going to leave it there because we do have a whole bunch of people on the line, and I want to make sure we get to as many as we can before the top of the hour. I hope that that was helpful to you, Ray. Let's go now to Trudy in the Seattle area, listening on 1050 AM. Trudy, you are on with Jimmy Akin. Your question, please.
Hi. Yes, I'm wondering what happens when you die. Do you actually go to heaven if you don't have a mortal sin, or do you need to go to purgatory before you go to heaven?
Okay.
I've heard different two different views on that.
Okay. The teaching of the Catholic Church is that if you die in God's friendship, so not in a state of mortal sin, then you will certainly go to heaven. But if there are continuing consequences of your sins that need to be dealt with, then you need to be purified, and that takes place in purgatory. And so, but on the other hand, if you die and all of the consequences of your sins have been dealt with already, then you would go straight to heaven because you don't need any further purification. And so that's the basic answer. If you die and you're already pure, you go directly to heaven. If you die and you're in God's friendship, but you still need to be cleaned up, then you'll go to purgatory first and then go to heaven.
Understand that. What do you mean you still need to be cleaned up? I'm sorry.
Well, all of us have, and this is an area where there's some diversity of opinion, but about exactly what is involved here. But all of us struggle with sin, and when we commit sin, a number of things happen. One of them is it builds sinful habits and tendencies in us. And over the course of the Christian life, as God gives us His grace, He encourages us to grow in holiness, but most of us are not completely holy by the time we die. And so one way or another, we need to be completely holy before we're in the full glory of heaven. And if we need to be, for example, cured of those sinful tendencies or healed of them, then that's something that purgatory would take care of. Also, some Catholic theological traditions speak of there being, they're called temporal punishments. Temporal means they don't last for all eternity, but there can be temporal punishments that are due to our sins. It's kind of like when a teenager, let's say, is acting reckless and you know, does something wrong and then apologizes. The parent may say, well, I forgive you, but you're still grounded for a week because you need to learn your lesson.
Right.
And in the same way, when we commit sin, we do damage to relationships and other people in the world, and or even just to ourselves. And to teach us a lesson, God can allow us to experience some of the consequences that we would deserve, just as a way, not just as a way of helping us learn our lesson and grow in holiness. And so that's something else that's commonly been understood to be part of purgatory.
Okay, so I'm assuming that most everybody's going to go to purgatory first, because we're not all going to be saints when we die.
Well, that's the view that Pope Benedict expressed in his encyclical Spe Salvi on Christian hope. He didn't say you have to believe that, but he indicated that his view was that most people are probably going to need some purification.
Trudy, thank you very, very much for that call. I hope that was helpful. We have to take a quick break, but before we do, I want to remind folks that we're continuing with our annual spring sale, but they're adding a special twist today for the rest of the day and throughout the weekend. All books, CDs, DVDs, ebooks, tracks, and MP3s are on sale. The sale runs from now till the end of the month, but beginning today and running through the weekend, when you use the promo code SPRING18 at checkout, you save 25%. That's in addition to the 15% already available for the spring sale. 25% all weekend at shop.catholic.com. Just use the code SPRING18 at shop.catholic.com. Get 25% off everything you purchase there. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more questions for Jimmy Akin on Open Forum Day on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
Hello, everyone. This is country music artist Colin Ray. Do what I do and keep it right here on Catholic Answers Live.
This is apologist Tim Staples, and I'm here to tell you about the most exciting and innovative Catholic book in years. In today's world, people from countless perspectives pose challenges to our Catholic faith every day. In conversations, through the mass media, on the internet, and more on the infinite collection of social media platforms. There's no getting away from this daily onslaught. We as Catholics need to stand strong to be prepared to mount a daily defense, to respond to the many challenges that we as believers are presented with every day. To that end, my good friend and apologist extraordinaire Jimmy Akin has come up with what will surely be a go-to resource for years to come, a daily defense. A daily defense takes up a different challenge for every day of the year, 366 in all, teaching you how you can defend the faith and give answers to Catholics and skeptics alike. And it's user-friendly, with challenges and answers indexed alphabetically by scripture verses or by topic, so finding the answers can be quick and easy. Order your copy of A Daily Defense today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Really, really busy open forum today on Catholic Answers Live, so I'm going to try to go quickly to get as many questions as I can answered before the top of the hour. So we'll go straight to Brittany in Santa Barbara, California, listening to EWTN. Brittany, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi there. Good afternoon. I have been married for about 7 years, and my husband and I did not get married the Catholic way, where we had a priest marry us or in the Catholic Church.
You did not?
No, we did not.
It was either one of you Catholic at the time of the marriage?
Yes, we're both Catholic.
Okay.
He just didn't want to do that for whatever reason.
Okay.
We have not bonded as a married couple in that, you know, to become one.
Do you mean the marriage has not been consummated?
It has been consummated, but we do not have a bond. We basically live separate lives.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't really have a marriage. But we are married civilly.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm considering getting a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering if there was never, our marriage was never recognized by the Catholic Church, and we never had that union to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
Am I able to receive the Eucharist?
Okay.
Given my situation.
Okay. Given your situation right now, all you need to do is go to confession. And after that, you could lead a normal sacramental life like any other Catholic. If you divorce your husband, that doesn't change that fact. If you would still be perfectly free to receive communion after you've been to confession to take care of any issues that you need to, like having gotten married outside the church and then having attempted to consummate that marriage because it was not valid in the eyes of the Catholic Church. So you'd want to confess those things. But then you'd be free to receive communion and the other sacraments just like any other Catholic, whether you end up divorcing your husband or not. Now, if you then want to marry somebody else, you'll want to document that the circumstances of your original marriage to show that it wasn't valid and therefore you're free to marry somebody else, that the fact that you, one or both of you, were Catholic at the time of the marriage and that you got married outside of the church without a dispensation for a non-Catholic marriage, all of that means that the marriage of itself was null from the beginning, regardless of what kind of what kind of bonding you had as husband and wife. So it wouldn't be an extensive process to get that marriage declared null. All you would need to do is produce the relevant documents to show that this is what happened, and you'd be eligible for an annulment. It's so easy to, in this kind of case, to show that, because it just involves producing some documents, that it's what's known as a documentary process annulment. And because you just have to, you know, show here's the marriage certificate from the court and there and record check to show you didn't have a to show that you were both Catholic. You know, you have at least one of you has a Catholic baptismal certificate, and there was no dispensation and so forth. And all of those documents will very easily show that the marriage was null, and therefore that you would be free to marry someone else if you chose to do that at a future date.
Okay, Brittany?
Yep, thank you so much. That makes perfect sense. Thank you for clarifying that.
No problem, and want to encourage the listeners to pray for you and your husband and everyone in similar situations.
I appreciate that call, Brittany. As I said, many, many calls on the line today. I'm just going to keep moving. Bridget in Vancouver, Washington, you are up next with Jimmy Aiken. Bridget, your question.
Well, I heard Mary a few weeks ago, and she said pray the rosary every day for 80 days, and in your opinion on that, and if there's any relation for 80 days to the Bible.
Okay. I'm not aware of an 80 days to the Bible program. How did you hear Mary say this? Did Mary say anything else to you, or just to pray the rosary for 80 days?
Just to pray the rosary for 80 days.
Okay. Has Mary ever said anything to you before?
Well, I haven't answered before.
Okay. And have you given her an answer at this point?
Well, I am saying the rosary.
Okay.
Every day.
Okay. Well, I would say that there's certainly no harm in saying the rosary for 80 days. Lots of people say it every day for periods a lot longer than 80 days. Having said that, you know, I would say if it were me, I'd say the rosary for 80 days and see if anything else happens at the end of that. Maybe something will, maybe something won't. I can't say for sure whether Mary actually spoke to you. I mean, we always have to acknowledge the fact that something could be our imagination. But if you say it for 80 days and something amazing happens, that would serve as confirmation that Mary had spoken to you. If you say it for 80 days and nothing happens, then I would say at least you had some good prayer. So nothing to worry about there. I would also say keep your parents informed about any thing you may think that you hear Mary or one of the other saints say to you. Let them know about it. They probably want to talk to a priest about it as well if you hear anything else. But as of right now, I would say keep doing what you're doing and be open to whatever God might do as a result, even if it's something that you never see any effects of, because sometimes God just wants us to pray for somebody else, and he'll help that other person even if we never know about it. So God will take your prayers and do something good with them.
Okay, Bridget?
Okay.
And you will keep your parents informed?
Yes, I will.
Very right. Good.
God bless you, sister. Thank you for that call. Thanks very much. I'm going to keep moving. We go now to Emma in Spokane, Washington. Emma, you are on with Jimmy Aiken. Your question, please.
Hi. I was just wondering if you could explain the different ranks of angels and their jobs.
Okay. Well, there are a number of different ranks of angels or kinds of angels that are described in Scripture. The basic description is angel, and that's a word it comes from a Greek word that means messenger. The Hebrew equivalent means the same thing. And that of itself gives you a sense of what one of their principal jobs is. That's to carry messages. Angels are depicted in the Bible. You know how God in the Bible is depicted as a king, as a heavenly king. Yeah. Well, every king has a court, and a group of people that kind of rule under him and with him and so forth. And like, so at a palace, one of the things you'll find is the king's messengers who send messages for the king. And so that's one of the principal jobs of the angels, is they're God's messengers. They're servants of God who he sometimes tasks with communicating messages. And we see an example of that in the Gospels, where Gabriel appears to the Virgin Mary and tells her she's going to have baby Jesus. So that's an example of a message that was delivered by an angel. There are also, there's at least one angel that's called an archangel. There really should be more than one, though. Archangel just means a high-ranking angel. Then there are creatures like the cherubim, which is from a Hebrew term that means the living ones, and there are the seraphim, which is from a Hebrew term that means the burning ones, and it's a little hard. There are other descriptions of angels as well. The church doesn't have an official teaching about exactly how many kinds there are or exactly what their jobs are, but we do know they carry messages for God. We also know that some of them protect people. Jesus talks about how the angels of little children always see the face of his Father. And the way I read that, it's like they're messengers who can always run back and have access to see God to tell him, yeah, here's what's happening with the child under my care. Please help them. And so we see angels guarding people in that way. Some of them, like Michael, guard whole groups of people. In the Old Testament, Michael was the special guardian of the nation of Israel, and today he's a special protector of the church as well. In various biblical books, we see angels in heaven worshiping God. We see them presenting the prayers of the saints to God, so they intercede for us. And we even see them depicted as running various physical forces in the universe. So they may have a role in maintaining some of the physical processes that we see in the universe. So basically, angels do whatever God wants them to, but those are some of the things that the Bible depicts angels as doing.
Okay, Emma?
Thank you. That makes a lot of sense.
Okay.
We try, Emma. Thanks very much. Appreciate the call. We're going to keep moving. We'll go to Harold in Somerset, Pennsylvania, listening on the EWTN app. Harold, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I'm here with my wife, Maggie, and I'm trying to help her. She's a Protestant, and you know, mm-hmm. she's very interested in the Catholic faith, and I'm trying to help mm-hmm. her understand. She always wonders what gives the Catholic Church and the Pope authority versus Church X, Y, or Z down the road.
Okay.
So if you don't mind, maybe you could take this call off the line.
Yeah, sure, no problem. So I would say a few things. The first one is, since you mentioned that your wife is coming from a Protestant perspective, I very much understand where she's coming from. I have a Protestant background too. And if you go to my personal webpage, jimmyakin.com, I have a paper I wrote, and I actually delivered it at a Protestant seminary once, called Why Be Catholic? An Exercise for Evangelicals. And so if you Google Why Be Catholic? Evangelicals, Jimmy Akin, it should come right up, and it'll go into this in more detail than I can explain here. But briefly, Jesus told Peter, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." And for a variety of reasons I cover in that paper, we know he's talking about Peter, not about Peter's faith or something else. He really is talking about Peter. And that means that Jesus built his church in particular on Peter, and also on the other disciples, but in particular on Peter, in the first century. He also said that the gates of hell would not prevail against it. So Jesus' church, the one that he gave his teaching authority to, because he gave Peter and the disciples the authority to teach, we're told that directly in the Gospels, that church is one that has existed since the first century. And we also know it's what you might call a visible church, one that has a discernible membership and disciplinary rules and things like that, because he also told Peter and later the other disciples that they would have the power to bind and loose. And from Jewish literature, we know that that involves the ability to make authoritative rules of conduct. He also, in Matthew 18, talked about how if someone sins against you and they won't listen to you and other people, take them to the church, and if they won't listen even to the church, treat them like a sinner or a tax collector. And so that is the process of excommunication. He gives the church authority to discipline members by, in some cases, excommunicating them, which means there's a visible, determinable membership to the church. So it's not just an invisible union of all believers. Instead, Jesus's church that he gave the authority to teach has existed from the first century, founded on Peter and the other disciples. It has a visible structure and membership, and in 2 Timothy, Paul says it's the pillar and foundation of truth. So when you look at the churches in the world today, the one that's based on Peter, the Pope today, that has existed since the first century, that's the Catholic Church.
Harold, thank you for that question. And Maggie, I hope that was helpful to you. Jimmy Akin, thanks for a great hour.
My pleasure.
Really enjoyed it. Tomorrow we're going to try something new. Our president will be here, our chaplain will be here, and we're going to have 2 hours of just wonderful Friday conversation. We hope you'll join us there. We'll try our brand new Friday kind of panel show that we're going to do. We'll see how it goes. Join us, and you can see how it goes tomorrow on Catholic Answers Live.